polymerase chain reaction is an in vitro enzymatic DNA replication technique to amplify a specific DNA segment of interest. Here, we are not amplifying the entire DNA. That was done by DNA library and all. Okay. Here, we are amplifying only a specific DNA segment. It is like taking just photocopy of a single page of a book. This scientist, Kary B Mullis, he improved the technique of PCR, so he got Nobel Prize. Why this is known as polymerase chain reaction? Because we use DNA dependent DNA polymerase, and this amplification reaction is a chain reaction. How the product of one reaction becomes the substrate for the subsequent reaction. That is why it is a chain reaction. Okay. See the overview of DNA replication in vivo. Okay. In our body, DNA helicase is involved in the separation of strand. DNA primase produces RNA primer. Then DNA polymerase comes. Okay. So we have already discussed this in DNA replication. Now it is time to differentiate DNA replication in vivo and PCR reaction. In PCR reaction, the primer we use is DNA primer. Okay. Instead of helicase, to separate the DNA strands, we use heat. As we are using heat, we cannot use thermolabile DNA polymerases. Okay. We have to use thermostable DNA polymerases. In our body, it is important to have proofreading activity. Okay. Otherwise, there will be mutation and cancer. But most of the time, PCR is a detection technique. We just want to see whether a particular sequence is present in the DNA or not. Okay. For that, most of the time, we do PCR. So, for that, we don't need that much proofreading activity. Okay. So, sometimes when needed, we use polymerases having proofreading activity. Most of the times, we don't use polymerases with proofreading activity. Okay. Components of PCR are template DNA, pair of DNA primers, thermostable DNA polymerase, deoxynucleotide triphosphates, and buffer with magnesium. Let us see the components one by one. Okay. So they can easily ask a question. All of the following are components of PCR except. Okay. So see the components. Template DNA. It should be at least 50 to 100 nanogram in amount. It should be free of contamination, proteins and lipids. You can isolate DNA from peripheral blood mononuclear cells, tissues, cultured cells, or even from dead cells like hair, nail and all. Okay. So, this is the way how we see the purity of DNA. 260-280 ratio. You know, the bases in the nucleic acids, they absorb UV length maximum at 260 nanometer. Aromatic amino acid, they absorb at 280 nanometer. Okay. So, we see the ratio between 260-280 ratio. We have already discussed this in nucleic acids video. Okay. See here, the 260-280 ratio is 1.8. It's pretty good. Now, what about primers? Why do we need primer? RNA polymerase does not require primer. It can start the synthesis from scratch. But DNA polymerase always require a free 3' OH group for its action. Okay. So, this is the region we are going to amplify. I told you, right? We are not amplifying the entire DNA. We are amplifying just a specific region of the DNA. So, this is the region to be amplified. So, when you separate the DNA strands by heat, that is 95 degrees Celsius. What is going to happen? The strands are separated. We have to amplify this strand, right? See here, this is 5' to 3', this is 3' to 5'. So, the direction of synthesis will be 5' to 3'. So, you have to synthesize in this direction, in this strand, here in this direction. So, based on this, we give the primer. So, we have to give the primer here. We have to give the primer here. Okay. So if you see, the primer here is nothing but the same sequence. Okay, see, they are complementary, right? So same sequence. So this is known as forward primer. Okay. Here we reverse this sequence and complement this sequence. That is why this is reverse complement sequence. This is known as reverse primer. Don't worry if you don't understand this reverse complement and all, it's not needed for your level. Okay. So there are two primers, forward and reverse. They are going to provide what? Free 3' OH group. This primer, we decide. Okay. We decide how to go for this. So when we design this primer, we have to consider certain points like the length. Imagine if you are going to use just 4 nucleotides, 4 oligonucleotides as a primers, what will happen? It has a chance that 4 to the 4 power of chance that it will go and bind to the region of DNA. So there will be non-specific amplification. Okay. So that is why we are going for 18 to 25 nucleotides. So there will be only one chance for this primer to go and bind to the DNA. Okay. So there will be specific amplification. We cannot go beyond 25. Why? Otherwise, we have to increase the melting temperature. The melting temperature should be between 55 to 65. If you use a long primer, the melting temperature will also increase. Annealing temperature is the temperature at which the primer comes and hybridizes with the template strand. Okay. This is very crucial. This annealing temperature should be lower than the melting temperature, because what is happening during melting? Strand separation. In annealing, hybridization. So the temperature should obviously be low. If you play around with the annealing temperature, you can increase the stringency of the PCR reaction. Okay. If annealing temperature is high, the stringency of the reaction is good. What is mean by stringency? The exact hybridization of primer. That means specific amplification is stringency. Okay. GC content should be between 40 to 60. If it is more GC content, what will happen? The melting temperature will also go very high, and they will hybridize with each other to produce secondary structures. There should not be any repeats like T, 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 T and all. There should not be any repeats, okay, in the primers. Now let us see about DNA polymerases. Primer gave 3' OH group. Now the DNA polymerase has to act on that. These polymerases are thermostable. See this thermos, pyro means fire, thermo, thermo, these are all thermostable. The scientists, they observed that in hot spring, bacteria are living. So, all their enzymes should be heat stable. That is how they deciphered this thermostable DNA polymerases. Okay, TAC polymerase is the most commonly used polymerase. It does not have proofreading activity. Okay. This PFU, all these polymerase, they have proofreading. How come these proteins are so thermostable? What could be the reason? You all know that these proteins always have hydrophobic residues at the core. Okay. Only the hydrophilic residues are at the surface. All the globular proteins, they will have hydrophobic residues at the core. These thermostable proteins, they have high amount of hydrophobic amino acids in the core, and the core size is bigger, so that the force is good. And there are other forces which stabilize the structure of the protein. So when the forces are so high, intramolecular forces are so high, the heat required to disrupt these forces is also high. Okay, this is how TAC polymerase is thermostable. See the characteristic of TAC polymerase. See, it can withstand 95 degrees Celsius. The half-life is 45 minutes. Okay. Extension is 2 kb to 4 kb per minute. Okay. It's a good extension rate. And see the processivity, 50 to 60 bases. What is processivity? Processivity is the number of nucleotides that can be added by a polymerase enzyme without falling from the template strand. So this polymerase can continuously add 50 to 60 bases. Okay. Before the invent of this tag polymerase, how did they do PCR reaction? They used thermolabile DNA polymerase, that is clinofragment. What is clinofragment? You know, DNA polymerase 1 contains 3 activities, 5 prime to 3 prime polymerase activity, 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity, 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease activity. Okay. So these are the activities. Clinofragment does not contain 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease activity. Okay. So every time, what will happen? In the heat, they are separating the DNA strand in 55 degrees Celsius, annealing, and they will add the primers. Okay. Here they add the DNA polymerase, that is your clinofragment. When they put this back again in 95 degrees Celsius, this clinofragment will get denatured. Okay. So at every step, they have to add DNA polymerase again and again, and they have to use 3 different water bath to change the temperature and all. So it's a cumbersome procedure. Okay. Now, as this is a polymerase chain reaction which is involving DNA, we have to give DNTPs. Okay. Deoxynucleotide triphosphate. Listen, we are not using DDNTPs. DDNTPs are dideoxynucleotide triphosphates. Okay. DNTPs, they contain free 3 prime OH group. DDNTPs, they do not contain free 3 prime OH group. Very important. As there is no free 3 prime OH group, DDNTPs, they will cause termination of the chain. Okay. So this is used in Sanger sequencing. Okay. Sanger's method of DNA sequencing uses DDNTP. All these enzymatic reactions need to be happen at a constant pH. Okay. The pH is maintained by buffer, and this buffer also contains divalent cation like magnesium, which is needed for the DNA polymerase. Okay. It's a cofactor. So we took all these components in a PCR tube. Okay. This is a tube. This is also heat stable. Okay. It can resist some heat. Okay. So we put all the components here. Okay. And this is the thermocycler. Some people call this as PCR machine. PCR machine is nothing but a thermocycler. What is it going to do? It is going to just change the temperature. Okay. It will change the temperature rapidly. That is very important. This rapid change is achieved by Peltier effect. You might have studied this in physics. This is known as Peltier effect. Okay. So we put all the components here and we keep in this. Then we have to program this PCR, that is your thermocycler. So we have to keep the temperature in 95 degrees Celsius for 3 minutes. Why? Imagine you are taking DNA, that is genomic DNA, it contains 3 billion base pair. So you have to separate all the hydrogen bonds. So that is why initially you give 3 minutes. Okay, this is known as initial denaturation of DNA. In the next steps and all, in the subsequent cycles and all, as primer is annealing, you just have to separate the what? Primer and template strand. So in the next subsequent cycles, no need for 3 minutes, just 10 seconds. Okay, so that is denaturation. Annealing. Annealing is where your primer is going to hybridize with the template strand. For this, you have to reduce the temperature. The temperature will be 60 degrees Celsius. See this, suddenly from 95, suddenly the temperature becomes 60 degrees Celsius. Okay. Then, for the tag polymerase to act, it needs optimum temperature of 72 degrees Celsius. Okay. So, that is why for 30 seconds, we give 72 degrees Celsius temperature. So these all we will set whenever we are going to do this PCR reaction, we set in this thermocycler. And this is 1x means it will happen for only once. 35x means it is going to happen for 35 times this chain of reaction. That is why it is polymerase chain reaction. After this extension, it will again go back denaturation, annealing, extension. This will be repeated up to 35 times. Okay. Then finally, we just give final extension. Okay. This is done. After that, the temperature is reduced to 4 degrees Celsius. Okay. This DNA is very stable. At 4 degrees Celsius, it is stable. You keep it. You can do the next steps. We will see after polymerase chain reaction what we should do. Before that, let us see what is happening inside the tubes now. Okay. So this is the genomic DNA. Okay. Then this is the primer. Okay. At 95 degrees Celsius, this is the initial denaturation. Okay. Then we add the primers. Okay. Everything is in the tube. Okay, everything is in the tube. Okay, we are not going to add actually. Everything is in the tube and the reaction happens. Okay, just because of the change in temperature, this reaction continues. So, at the end of first cycle, you will have two products. Okay, so first cycle, you will have two products, 2 to the power of 1, 2 products. At the end of second cycle, what will you have? You will have 2 to the power of 2, that is 4 products. At the end of third cycle, you will have 2 to the power of 3 products, that is 8. And notice here, you have short products and long products. Okay. The long products, these long products, the amplification of this long products is just linear. Okay. But short products are amplified in logarithmic phase, 2 to the power of 3. It is actually the amplification of short products. Okay. This logarithmic amplification is because of the strategic location of our primer. Okay. We are just amplifying the specific region. We are not amplifying the entire DNA. Okay. What decreases the chance of parent DNA annealing together? Okay. We melt. Okay, we denaturate the DNA strands. Once we reduce the temperature, what will happen? There is a chance that these two template strands will anneal with each other, hybridize with each other. How is this prevented? It is because of the basic stoichiometry. Okay, you have excess primers. So, the probability of primers binding to the template is higher than the probability of template joining with each other. Okay, but having said these, during course of PCR reaction, what will happen? The number of DNA strands will increase. Okay, so ultimately this DNA strands will outnumber the primers. So after 20-25 cycles and all, the efficiency of polymerase chain reaction decreases. Okay, so finally, you got amplification, you amplified specific region of DNA. Okay, logarithmic amplification happened, billion fold amplification and all you did. What will you do with this amplified products? Okay, these products are known as amplicons. Amplified products are known as amplicons. What are you going to do with this? When you design primer itself, you know how much is the product length, okay, 350 kb, this may be the, 350 base pairs, it's not kb, okay, 350 base pairs, it can be 350 base pairs. So, you know that the product you will get is 350 base pairs. If you are not getting, that means the specific gene is not present. For example, you want to see the presence of some bacteria. Okay, you take the unique sequence of that bacteria and you amplify that sequence. Okay, you know the product size is 350 base pairs. So you have to use a ladder. A ladder is nothing but DNA fragments of known size. For example, 50 base pair, 100, 150, 200, like that, the ladder size will be there. Okay, according to the size, they will separate. Okay, the small size will move faster. Okay, see, the small size will move faster. So you also use a positive control. Use the bacteria having the known sequence and all, you use this. And these are all the patient samples. Whether the patient is infected with bacteria or not, that we are going to detect. If the same sequence is present, what will happen? You will get the band. You will get the PCR band of desired length. Getting the band is not important. The band should be of the desired length. If you get multiple bands, that means the amplification is not specific. You have to play around with the annealing temperature to get the specific product length. Okay. So after PCR, you have to do DNA electrophoresis. Okay. Then only you can confirm that PCR reaction is successful. Okay. Reverse transcriptase PCR is also known as RT-PCR. Okay. What is a reverse transcriptase? It is an enzyme which convert RNA to DNA. We know that transcription is the one in which RNA is produced from DNA. Here, the reverse transcription is happening. Okay, RNA is now converted into DNA. That is why this is reverse transcriptase. Okay. The enzyme is reverse transcriptase. Can you tell me a reverse transcriptase which is present in human body? Yeah, telomerase. Telomerase is an example for a reverse transcriptase present in human body. Okay. These enzymes are present in retroviruses like HIV. Most of the times we use the reverse transcriptase derived from these viruses. Mallony strain of murine leukemia virus. Reverse transcription happen at 37 to 42 degrees Celsius using DNA primers. Okay. Let us see how priming strategy is achieved. Okay. So, you all know that all the messenger RNA have poly A tail in the 3 prime end. Okay. So, if you put oligo DT primer, oligo DT means a few stretch of thymine. Okay. These are all DNA primer because we have to synthesize DNA from RNA. Okay. And that too, that DNA is complementary to the RNA. That is why it is cDNA. That is why it is cDNA. So now this oligo DT will act as a primer. It will provide free 3 prime OH group and this cDNA can be produced. Okay. The problem with oligo DT primer is if the mRNA is very big, the reverse transcriptase will lose the efficiency after a certain stretch. Okay. So incomplete cDNA production will happen. To avoid this, we use random primer techniques. What is this technique? So, computer will generate some random primers. Okay. It may generate A, T, G, C, G, A. So, this is a random primer. There is a chance that this random sequence, this is 6 number, right? There is a chance that this six sequences are present in the RNA complementarily. So, this will go and hybridize with the RNA. So, there is a chance that multiple random primers can bind. Okay. So, we get multiple priming sites. So, now this increases the efficiency of cDNA synthesis. Okay. Multiple reverse transcriptases can come and do the cDNA synthesis. The disadvantage of oligo-DT primer is that only those RNA containing poly A tail can be reverse transcribed. You know, histone mRNA does not contain a poly A tail. And if you want other RNAs like rRNA and all, you have to use different technique. You can use random primer also. If you want specific RNA, for example, RNA for insulin, you want just insulin messenger RNA, then what will you do? At that time, you can have the sequence of insulin mRNA and design a primer accordingly. Okay. So now the cDNA of insulin mRNA will be produced. Okay. The advantage of random primer is you are creating cDNA for total RNA. Okay. All the RNA are converted into cDNA. In oligo-DT primer, only those RNA having poly A tail are converted. In sequence specific, this is so specific, only a particular type, a particular species of mRNA is converted into cDNA. Okay. So now you can answer this question. Starting material for production of insulin in bacteria is genomic DNA from RBCs, mRNA from WBCs, genomic DNA from pancreatic beta cell, mRNA from pancreatic beta cell. Can it be DNA? You know, bacteria don't have splicing mechanism. Okay. So it cannot splice. So you cannot use DNA. Okay. Now, can you use mRNA from WBCs? You know that insulin gene is expressed only in pancreatic beta cell. Okay. So we have to take mRNA from pancreatic beta cell. See, we take the mRNA, we convert it into cDNA, then we put it into the vector, then expression of insulin is done. Okay. See, these are the steps of RT-PCR, that is reverse transcriptase PCR. mRNA is there, we used primers and we are producing cDNA. This is done at 42 degrees Celsius. Okay. See, when initially synthesized, cDNA has only one strand. That is why the kit that comes for cDNA synthesis always says that first strand cDNA synthesis kit. Okay, see here, there is only one strand. When you do PCR, we give primers, okay, cDNA is converted into double stranded DNA. Okay, as such, reverse transcription produces single strand, that first strand of cDNA. Okay. In PCR, we amplify this. Okay. It becomes double stranded DNA. Okay. The rest of the PCR portion is similar to that PCR only. Okay. The difference is we use cDNA instead of genomic DNA or other DNA. Okay. Application, you all know that the test for detection of HIV uses reverse transcriptase PCR. Okay. Now, we are coming to the other type of PCR, which is real-time PCR. Okay. This is not RT-PCR. Okay. Whenever you want to say that it is real-time PCR, use qPCR or you can also use qRT-PCR. The word Q is very, very important. It is quantitative PCR. Here, we are going to quantify how much amount of RNA is present. Okay, that is why it is quantitative PCR. So, this is a way of measuring the gene expression. Okay. The main difference between traditional PCR and real-time PCR is the time of detection. Here, the time of detection is at real time. Okay. In traditional PCR, what we did, that after 35 cycles and all, we do electrophoresis. Okay. We don't know whether the reaction is happening or not, how much initial DNA was there. Here, we do this at real time. Real time PCR also requires RT reaction, that is reverse transcription. Okay. We first reverse transcribe the mRNA or RNA, some RNA. Okay, we do reverse transcription, we produce cDNA, then we subject this cDNA to qPCR. Okay, in qPCR we use a fluorescent reporter, that is your cyber green. We pronounce this as cyber green, SYBR green. This is a dye which goes and binds to the double stranded DNA. This binds to only double stranded DNA. Okay, in PCR, when will this double stranded DNA forms? During extension. Okay, so this SYBR will go and bind whenever the DNA extension phase is happening. Okay, and after the concentration of SYBR reaches a particular amount, it will now fluoresce. Okay, because for every molecule there is a threshold. Okay, so there will be a fluorescent threshold. After reaching that threshold, SYBR will fluoresce. Okay, this fluorescence is detected by the machine. Here you have to just understand this concept, CT value. CT value or CT number is the cycle number at which threshold fluorescence is achieved. I will tell you in a very simple way. There are two samples in which 5 mRNA was initially present. Here 10 number of mRNA is present. So you create cDNA. So you get 5 cDNA, you get 10 cDNA. When you do real time PCR, what will happen? This 10 cDNA is there. So multiple SYBR can go and bind. Okay, there is chance of binding SYBR is high. Here it is low. So what will happen? The CT value, otherwise in less number of cycle, the fluorescence will be achieved. Okay, here the number of DNA is high, so the CT value will be low. Okay, this is the basis. So see here, CT value is the cycle number at which threshold fluorescence is achieved. Okay, CT value will be inversely proportional to the initial amount of DNA, cDNA. Okay, this cDNA will be directly proportional to mRNA, right? Okay, so this CT value is important to quantitate the gene expression. Okay, see here, this is the showing the real time PCR. You can see the CT value. See here, here, so around 23rd cycle CT value, otherwise threshold is achieved. So the CT value is 23. Okay, here if you see, around 28th cycle threshold fluorescence is achieved. So CT value is 28. So now you know that the sample which achieved threshold earlier, otherwise the sample which low CT value, contain more DNA or RNA. Okay, this is very simple to understand. Here we actually have to compare using some control. For example, we use housekeeping genes. We use the expression of housekeeping genes like beta actin, gap DH, that is your glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, because the level of this enzyme in cells is constant. Okay, their expression is constant. So we use these genes as control. We compare the expression of other genes in comparison with them. So, but these details are not necessary for you. Just you should know about the CT value. The advantage of real-time PCR is that amplification is monitored in the real time. Okay, you can see in the computer screen that whether the fluorescence is happening or not, all these things. And the detection is capable down to less than 2-fold change. You can say that there are two samples. This samples contain 1.8-fold higher mRNA than the previous sample. Okay, this is also possible. In ordinary PCR and all, you have to do electrophoresis to confirm the successful PCR reaction. Here there is no need to do any electrophoresis because in real time you are seeing. Just you have to find out the CT value. From the CT value, we calculate something delta Ct and delta delta Ct. 2 to the power of delta delta Ct value will give you your fold change. Okay. This is not needed for you, just I am giving extra information. 2 to the power of delta delta Ct will give you the fold change. Okay. Have a look at the applications of PCR. Answer this question. Which of the following is not required in PCR? We have to use DNTP. We cannot use DDNTP. Okay. Primer we need because we have to get a 3' OH group. Tag polymerase, very important. Radio label DNA probe, we don't use. In fish, we use fluorescent DNA probes and all. Okay. We don't use radio label DNA probe in PCR. All of the following are commonly used methods for detection of mutation except DNA sequencing is the gold standard method because we directly get the sequence of the DNA. So, it is the gold standard. PCR and all we are indirectly getting. Okay. Single strand conformational polymorphism, that is also a technique to detect the mutation for especially SNP. SNP we pronounce it as SNP, single nucleotide polymorphism. Okay. These three can be used to detect mutation but not ligase chain reaction. Cyber green dye is used for, very simple, we use PCR. Okay. Now there are certain questions which you should be of very sure, the answer should you know. Okay. See here, cation used in PCR is magnesium. Rapid method for detection of intersex is, whenever someone is asking you this question, you should be able to answer immediately. Fish. Sanger's reagent is dinitrofluorobenzene. Technique for exact localization of a genetic locus. Fish. Prenatal diagnosis of hemophilia is best done by PCR. Okay. So, there are certain questions like this which you should know by heart. Okay. This concludes the session on polymerase chain reaction.